Welcome, everybody, to this Hurricane Milton edition of the Beyond the Drop podcast. Unfortunately, we have to record on a Monday night because down here at Free Drop Central, we are facing a hurricane evacuation. I'm getting out of town tomorrow morning. Me and the family headed up to Panama City Beach, hopefully to avoid this hurricane, which we're all crossing our fingers. Gets a little weaker as it gets closer to the coast here. It's been a bad few weeks here in Florida. And thoughts go out to everybody who is recovering from Helene and having to deal with this Hurricane Milton. So unfortunately, tonight, Mike is not with us. He can't be here tonight, and I can't be here tomorrow. So I'm going to drop a quick pod tonight, cover everything that happened in football, baseball, golf. And then Mike will be back next week. But we also, to be sure, have Mike's picks in. He sent me his $1,000 picks for next week. They are bangers. I can't wait to share those with you a little bit later. Before we get to all that, I just want to thank everybody who joined freedrop.org and stepped in and made a donation or purchased one of our vintage packages, our bundles that went out as our first merch drop. We're so grateful. We hope we can keep pushing that. If you want to visit freedrop.org, Freedrop is our sponsor, our production company. We've been really, really blessed to have such a great following and hope we can build that from here. And if you want to help support us, go check out that website. Check out our vintage bundle and check out our campaign, our listener-supported campaign on Indiegogo.com. Search Free Drop. You can find that link on our social media as well. And we'll get right to this abbreviated pod after this drop. Welcome to the Beyond the Drop podcast. Here in Florida from Hurricane Central, we are trying to dodge Milton. Quick pod tonight to get us out of the way of this storm. Hope everybody who is moving out of Florida is safe and sound. Shout out to all of our Nashville peeps who reached out to me and my family today looking out. We are going to head out tomorrow to evacuate from the storm. And God willing, you know, it's not as bad as it looks as it comes in. But to all the people who are fleeing the storm and recovering from Helene, our thoughts are with you, and we want to do a quick pod tonight just to check our boxes, make sure you have something to listen to. We're dropping our normal time on Wednesday morning, but this is being recorded on Monday night. I actually have the Chiefs and the Saints on in the background. Just want to cover a few quick topics tonight. You know, as we looked at this week, especially in football, it seemed to be a snoozer. The college football slate in particular was not terribly exciting, and that all changed on Saturday afternoon, early evening. Obviously, our base for this podcast is Nashville, Tennessee. And full disclosure, personally, I have bandwagoned the Vanderbilt Commodores a number of times in the 25 years I lived in Nashville, ever since they had Jay Cutler and DJ Moore and just some fun teams, Woody Woodenhofer as the coach, and then, of course, through some really down times. And I have a lot of friends who are Vanderbilt alum, a lot of former students who attend and have graduated from Vanderbilt University. It's a school that I've been to many, many times, coached high school games on their main floor, seen their men's and women's teams play in person many times, been to football games, the basketball teams, been to football games numerous times. Heck, I even saw a U2 concert in Vanderbilt's football stadium. So I have a really big affinity for that program, but I'd be lying if I said I was a huge fan. But anybody who loves football had to love what happened on Saturday. Vanderbilt University with their, I mean, it's probably safe to say their biggest win ever. Their first upset win over a number one program in school history. Vanderbilt defeats the University of Alabama, which is really obviously ironic. Since last week on this podcast and our social media, we basically said Alabama might be the team to beat. You know, the game of the year, beating Georgia at home. And they forgot that they have to come out and play every week in the SEC, and this Vanderbilt program, which has lost a bad game at Georgia State a few weeks ago, but showing real signs of promise competitively. A big win over Virginia Tech earlier in this year. And what you've seen from Vanderbilt is kind of the fits and starts of a program that is reinvigorating itself. They've obviously recruited some great players. And of course, they have a coach that has kind of fostered a belief, not just in the team itself, but in recruits, you know, recruits who are now visiting campus in a way that they've never seen before, bringing the best out of players that maybe a few years ago they may not have seen coming into their program, but also getting the best of the talent that they typically get. And starting with their quarterback, Diego Pavia, who was amazing in that football game. You know, the fourth down touchdown pass that really went from Vanderbilt may have a kind of fleeting hope in this game to Vanderbilt might actually win this game in the third quarter. Was amazing. You know, you can sense it in the crowd. Honestly, I didn't watch the first half. I kind of just assumed, like everybody else, this would not be a very close football game. Been watching the score. Mike and I started texting each other, and then things got really excited after that touchdown pass on fourth down and how they hung out and the character they showed in winning that game. And, you know, one of the things that Mike texted me, and we both kind of texted each other, was this never happens under Nick Saban. This is not something that he would take lightly. And looks like DeBoer has some challenges ahead to stay focused week to week, because Nick Saban would focus on Vanderbilt like they were Georgia. You know, he would focus like Vanderbilt was the number one team in the country. And that clearly was not the mentality that Alabama had walking into that stadium. All that said, Alabama didn't play poorly. Milroe was great. Vanderbilt's, you know, defense held pretty well. They broke a couple times, but they did just enough. And the Vanderbilt offense was excellent. And at the end of the day, winning on the road in the SEC, despite what Saban said, which played on the, you know, the Jumbotron afterwards, Vanderbilt's not an easy place to play. I think they've reinvigorated their school. Nashville has become kind of an it city. Certainly the students know how to celebrate. It was maybe the whitest celebration ever. It took them about an hour to get the goalpost down. Then they marched him down Broadway and threw him in the Cumberland River, which, come on. I mean, why throw him in the Cumberland River? Someone just has to fish those out so some barge doesn't hit them. So I'd, you know, kind of question the Vanderbilt students on that one. Bunch of smart kids. I don't know if they should be throwing goalposts in the river. But that said, you can't fault them for celebrating. What you can fault is Vanderbilt, Alabama, for not taking Vanderbilt seriously. What's weird about all this, in the age of the 12-team playoff, it may not matter. In fact, it probably won't matter. If Alabama does what they should do, which is run the tables the rest of the year, lose one more, they should be easy qualifiers for that. But it does speak a lot to the parity in college football. It speaks a lot to programs that are constantly shuffling players, coaches. You know, the nil contracts have changed the dynamics of players in these programs. The transfer portal has changed the dynamic of players moving between programs. And schools like Alabama are much more obviously affected by those type of, you know, I should say struggles, if nothing else, to meet the needs of their student athletes. And teams like Vanderbilt and some of these smaller schools in the Power Four, or even the other conferences in the Bowl Championship Series, you know, they may have more continuity in their programs. They may have players that are there for academic reasons, that spend 4 years there, that learn the systems, that are program players. And it does bring some parity to the sport. And I think we saw a little bit of that on Saturday. So, you know, anchor down, shout out. It was awesome. It was fun to watch. I was so, so happy for my friends, Vanderbilt alum. I think about Jay Salado out there. I think about my buddy John Wilson, Amber Pierce, a good friend of the family and the podcast. So many of my former students who went off to Vanderbilt. Joseph Williams, good friend of the podcast. List goes on and on. And it was just so fun to see them enjoy their program, having their signature moment, and hopefully more under Coach Lee, who has been fantastic. And, you know, we'll see what happens in the next couple weeks if Vanderbilt can keep this momentum going. I would certainly think they earned, in light of the parity in college football, some votes into the top 25. We'll see if that happens. If nothing else, just a big, big hallmark in that school's football program in a week that it looked like college football was going to kind of be on the back burner to the NFL and to the MLB playoffs. And probably the team that is next happiest about, I shouldn't say happiest, but grateful for the Vanderbilt upset of Alabama would be Tennessee, who really laid an egg against the University of Arkansas. You know, Arkansas, not a bad team, not the bottom dwellers they have been, but Tennessee that had shown the offensive and defensive proclivities that really were evident in national championship contenders did not have that recipe. And it snuck under the radar as Tennessee lost. It again, how much will this hurt them in the long run? We'll see. How many teams from the SEC will make the playoffs? It looks like maybe five. And that would certainly put Tennessee right in that position to make the playoffs as long as they don't have any more slip-ups. It does make the Tennessee-Vanderbilt game later this year kind of interesting. But Tennessee loses to Arkansas. In fact, you had five teams in the top 11, and really Miami could have been there very, very easily as they almost lost to a gamey Cal team. But five upsets in the top 11, you know, two of those are Big Ten teams. USC loses and Michigan loses. I want to say that the Missouri upset at the hands of Texas A&M is an upset, but it's really not. Texas A&M is a better football team than Missouri. If you've been following Missouri, they've not won very convincingly. They just had a decent record. So, but that said, there's another top 11 team that lost. Who wins? What's the shakeup look like? Well, Texas back on top. Ohio State, who really hasn't played anybody. You know, they beat an Iowa team that was clearly outmatched this weekend as hard as they play. Georgia, weirdly enough, after that close loss to Alabama, kind of sneaks back up into the top five. It makes the rankings goofy. It does make you wonder if they even matter. I would be very curious to see how these AP rankings match up with the actual, you know, playoff rankings when we see them come out here in 4 weeks, I think, is when we'll see the first round of those. So does it all really matter? No. Does it make for great Saturday viewing? Yes. But the biggest news here is shout out to our Nashville friends who are Vanderbilt Commodore alum, students, fans. You know, this one was for you. Beyond the Drop is really excited for you. We celebrated like crazy on that one. Let's turn to the NFL really quickly. You know, as bad as the games were in week four, and Mike and I went over kind of the playoff possibilities, and that shuffled a little bit maybe with the results from on Sunday this week. But what was very clear is that the NFL, much like college, has a lot of parity in it. You have a ton of 3-2 and 2-3 teams right now. Trying to forecast the playoffs, especially the NFC, is almost impossible. But you start to see what some of these teams are made of and the character of some of these teams after Sunday's action. And one game in particular stuck out, maybe the NFL game of the year, Baltimore, with an incredible overtime win, come from behind against Cincinnati. You know, the Bengals just seem like they're snake bit. Joe Burrow was awesome, 5 touchdown passes. He got hit so freaking hard in that game, time after time after time, and he kept getting up. I mean, the guy's a warrior, if nothing else. You know he's battling injuries. It's a game that Cincinnati had to have, 10-point lead, 4th down. You know, maybe the play of the year in the NFL, Lamar Jackson, who I don't know if there's ever been a quarterback quite like him who will physically take as much punishment as he takes and yet still perform in the fourth quarter, fumbles a snap, 4th down. It's a have to have a touchdown drive here to have any chance to force overtime. Rolls out to his right, hits Lively in the end zone, running away from him. You know, a right-hander running to his right, hitting a receiver running across the goal line opposite his right hand. It was an incredible throw. You've all seen it by now. It reminds you that this Baltimore team can't be taken lightly. It was also a reminder of how brutal the AFC North can be, how hard they hit when those teams play each other, whether it is Baltimore-Cincinnati or Baltimore-Pittsburgh or, you know, Pittsburgh and anybody in that division, even Cleveland, you know, who I feel somewhat sorry for at this point. If you're a Browns fan who thought this was going to be your year, clearly Deshaun Watson's not the answer there. Your offensive line is in tatters. Washington ran amok all over you. But that said, AFC North is a really, really competitive division, and that game was awesome. Baltimore, can't say they're the best team in the AFC, but they have made a statement. You know, Buffalo 1 week, big win against Cincinnati, even though they're not, you know, by record, one of the better teams in the division or in the conference. Pretty impressive, if not for what Houston did, as they won in overtime against the Bills. So a couple overtime games, really, really great games. And to Baltimore's credit, a game that they could have lost very easily, you know, given Derrick Henry the football, letting him do what he does. It felt very similar to what Houston did, you know, kind of let's put our nose down. Cam Akers running the football with Joe Mixon out. Bryce Young doing Bryce Young things. In my mind, when I watched both those games, I saw two teams that were really probably the top two favorites to make to the AFC Championship game. I'm probably not breaking news here just because it's kind of hard to identify who else other than the Chiefs and the AFC is going to be on that level. But if you were to ask what three teams, you know, might be providing the two contenders for the AFC Championship, I would say it's going to be Kansas City, Houston, Baltimore. I think it's pretty obvious at this point that they have separated themselves, the wheat from the chaff. So anyway, great week in the AFC. In the NFC, man, it just seems like the Vikings are the class of the conference. Going over to England, you know, playing, and I think they were in Tottenham in Hotspur Stadium. And, man, the Jets looked bad. And the Vikings made them look bad. And Rodgers was, he looked injured for a while and certainly came out of the game looking like he was injured, about to go into the blue tent and came back on the field. But it just looks like they're out of sorts and a really poorly coached team. They didn't look prepared for that game. You can see after halftime, the Vikings made adjustments, especially in their secondary press coverage, made it really hard for Rodgers to find any space to throw the football. Got himself hit several times. And when you're 40 years old, man, I'm just telling you, stubbing your toe on the bedpost will leave you wounded for a week. So how Rodgers is going to recover from some of the hits he took at the hands of the Vikings is going to be interesting to see. So the Jets, a team going one direction, the Vikings establishing themselves in another direction. Another team that surprised this week, you know, we talked about the Redskins rolling the Browns and being one of the class of the NFC. But the Falcons, you know, a thriller over the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. This podcast has kind of favored the Buccaneers this year. And then on Thursday night, Kirk Cousins goes bananas. And if you think about how bad the NFC South could be, to see how competitive those games are, and Carolina aside, even New Orleans has been really gamey this year. I know they had a rough stretch, and looks like they're facing a rough one tonight on the road at Kansas City. But that's a division that should be a lot of fun to watch play out at the end of the year. What am I saying? I'm saying the NFL is worth the Sunday ticket, absolutely. The parity in the league has made it a lot of fun. You know, as a Bears fan, I've really enjoyed the NFC North. I've enjoyed watching Caleb Williams' development. I talked to a buddy of mine who's a fellow Bears fan. This is one of the first games we can remember in a long time where we didn't have to sweat the fourth quarter or, you know, fear some disaster. It just felt like the Bears had it in hand. We have only five games in. It seems like we have a very proficient professional NFL quarterback, someone who is only going to get better and better. So even me personally, my, you know, prospects in the league are great. So it's been a lot of fun to watch. Very quickly, Major League playoffs started this week. And this is where my rant from last week needs to carry over. The Milwaukee Brewers, my hometown team, lost in tragic fashion in a stupid, ridiculous three-game series against the New York Mets. You know, I lamented last week, 162-game season. You have a team that wins their division, has one of the best run differentials in the entire Major League Baseball standings, and yet they have to play a three-game series against a team that has been pretty hot with a couple good starting pitchers and really a murderer's row of a lineup, and it just doesn't seem fair. You know, the Brewers, despite that, forced a third game with a huge second game two rally and then carried a 2-0 lead into the bottom of the ninth before the most reliable closer in baseball, Devin Williams, who had only allowed one home run all year and only three runs all year, and granted, he'd had some injury issues, gives up four runs in the top of the ninth. The Brewers lose to the Mets 4-2. The Mets now move on. They're 1-1 with the Phillies as we speak tonight. And it really is disappointing that the Major League front office couldn't get this right. I know they want the TV revenue. That extra wild card round, of course, pays them money that they need because viewership's going down. But man, it just seems to make so much more sense to have two wildcard teams. Those two teams play each other to earn the right to play the number one seed. And then the 2 and 3 seeds, the 2 and 3 division winners, play each other in a 5-game series. And if the Brewers lose a 5-game series, I'm good with it. But after 162 games, to have such a small sample size in your playoff series makes no sense. We've seen 3-game series all year in Major League Baseball. Anybody can win the best of three. The White Sox won 3 best of 3 series this year, and they were one of the most historically poor teams who's ever played the game. baseball needs to figure this out. Feel terrible for Brewers fans. Texting with my buddies while we watched that game. It was like a, man, the emotions of getting the two home runs, you know, in the seventh inning. And then having one out and your all-world closer in the game in the ninth inning, only to lose that game, was just a pain as a sports fan. I don't know if I can equate it to much in my life. And I've been around for a lot of painful sports moments. I hope Major League Baseball does something about it. They probably won't. It is fun to note that, you know, you have Detroit and Cleveland and Kansas City still duking it out, trying to make their way to the World Series. Unfortunately, Detroit and Cleveland are playing each other. Kansas City 1-1 with the Yankees. But just like Mike and I talked about last week, it just feels like this will end up with the big money teams, you know, the Dodgers or the Yankees or the Padres, you know, teams that are in big media markets. And yes, San Diego is a big media market. It's right outside of LA. It just feels like that's what we're going to see again. And it just, maybe it's great for the league and those TV markets. Maybe it's great for kind of national fan bases because the Dodgers and Yankees travel really well. But it does continually separate the small, you know, market teams from the big teams. And man, if Detroit, Cleveland, or KC can sneak in there, it'd mean all the world to us small market fans. Golf this week, not much to talk about in the U.S. Kevin Yu won the Sanderson Farms, one of these fall events that is just kind of played out after a long golf season. What's interesting is Kevin Yu, who most of you have never heard of, his first tour win, he wins $1.3 million. Thank you, Tiger Woods. Thank you, Liv. Thank you, Strategic Sports Group. Kevin Yu now has a little more financial security, certainly, because of that. But interesting that, you know, you did see some bigger names, Brant Snedeker, Ricky Fowler, and Gary Woodland had a big week. So those guys all top 20, trying to make their way into that top 70 headed into 2025, earning some, at least in the first three signature events, earning some playing time. So, but the bigger news was the Dunhill Lynx at St. Andrews, a European tour event that has a private owner, private sponsor, who opened up the field to LIV players. And 14 of the top names in LIV played. And more importantly, if you follow the news, Yersiel Ramayan and Jay Monahan played together in the Pro-Am. This is a big Pro-Am. It's just a basically, you know, a big celebrity get-together. And Monahan and Yassir played together. Monahan played with Billy Horschel. Yassir played with Dean Burmester of LIV. And they spent a lot of time talking. And cameras caught them quite close, hands covering, cupped over their mouths. It feels like, if nothing else, we're moving towards something. I contend still that LIV does not have a ton of incentive to draw a clear, equal agreement with the PGA Tour. That said, it was at least some sign of progress. Interesting tournament, too, at St. Andrews, having all the LIV guys there who played actually very well. Koepka had a good showing, won by a LIV player. Tyrrell Hatton won the event itself. So, again, another kind of feather in the cap for the LIV Golf League. Yassir kind of being, I wouldn't say invited. He was invited, but kind of recognized on the global professional golf stage alongside the commissioner of the PGA Tour. A bunch of PGA players like Billy Horschel, who won a few weeks ago, playing alongside the best of the LIV Tour, the Rahms and the Koepkas. It was a pretty interesting outcome. And it's just another sign that we are closing in on some sort of detente between these two leagues, but also a world where we're going to have to accept and hopefully flourish with these two leagues operating independently and sharing players, which is where it seems like it's going to go. All right, let's wrap this thing up. It's been a short but sweet podcast, but no Beyond the Drop podcast will be complete without Mike's $1,000 picks. I'm sad that Mike can't be here. Some interesting picks coming our way from him tonight. He went 3-1-1 last week. The tie in his bet last week was this bizarre Colts cover. He had Jacksonville -3 at Jacksonville. That game was well in hand, 10-point game, 13-point game. The Colts with Joe Flacco cover at the end. I guarantee you this game never covers if Richardson's in the game. And yet we only get the push out of it. It's the old classic backdoor push. At least you get your money back. Tough one for Mike. Two of the three overs hit, so we won two of the overs. We won the Louisville SMU over, Mike's kind of bet from the heart pick, and the Navy and Air Force pick, which seemed good, too good to be true. Well, it actually was true. So that one hit, and you could tell that was going to hit it at halftime. They were within 10 points of that one. Navy looked really good in that game. And then finally, on Sunday Night Football, the Cowboys pulled one out against the Steelers. That was a Mike's big bet, a money line bet, which gets us, you know, some positive, you know, return on our investment. The Cowboys eke one out on the road, a rainy night, long rain delay. I tried to stay up for that whole game. I fell asleep into the third quarter, and I woke up and the game was over, and the Cowboys had won. So shout out to Mike, 3-1-1 this week. I hate he's not here to gloat and to shove it in my face, because I certainly, I'm going to say I question his picks. I did question that Dallas pick. I just thought Dallas was beat up, but their backs were against the wall. And credit to them, they came out and won a really physical game on the road against a pretty good Pittsburgh team. So 3-1-1 last week. We ended up winning $211.82. And on the year, we are still down 729.71, but we've made some big strides the last couple weeks to cut into that deficit. So shout out to Mike. And now let's go over his $1,000 picks for this week. Mike is feeling the overs a little bit. And his first pick this week is a $100 bet. He is betting the Cincinnati Bengals and the New York Giants to go over 48.5 points. Now, on the surface, that seems, man, like a crazy bet. These teams aren't very good, yet the Giants have won a couple games in a row, just beat a pretty good Seattle team, and the Bengals can score points if nothing else. Joe Burrow with 5 touchdown passes. It seems like 48.5 might be a little low for that, and Mike is going to take the value on that. So the first bet of the week is the over on the Cincinnati-New York Giants game, $100 bet over 48.5. One more $100 bet this week, and this is going to the college ranks, and he is going to take the points. And I can't speak to this one. I know Utah is a decent football team. It's hard to judge, especially with all the movement in the Big 12 and the Pac-10, who are the really good football teams. But Arizona State is getting 6.5 points versus Utah. Mike sees value in those 6.5 points. He's going to take Arizona State plus 6.5 against Utah, $100 bet. Again, it seems to be a league where anybody can beat anybody in any given week. And 6.5, almost a full touchdown, seems like pretty good value. So Mike's second pick, plus 6.5 Arizona State over Utah. His third pick, not a mortgage bet, but a little bigger number here. This one hurts me a little bit. I'm going to be honest. I told Mike, I texted him. This one feels a little painful to me, but I'm going to live with it. I understand why he's making this bet. He sees a team that is pretty desperate for a win. He sees a team also that is playing in familiar confines, not a home game, but familiar confines against a team that has not traveled this far to play football. So he has a Jacksonville and Chicago Bears bet playing in London. He is going to take the money line on Jacksonville over the Chicago Bears in England on Saturday. Again, I can't get too mad about this. The Bears probably due for, I don't know, I'm not going to say a huge letdown, maybe a little bit of letdown. The Jaguars certainly seem desperate for a victory. The game itself being, you know, across the ocean, and the Jaguars, I think right now, I don't have, you know, the odds sitting in front of me. The Jaguars are definitely the underdog here. And so the money line value is pretty good here. You're getting, I think, plus 115 on the Jaguars on a money line bet and a game that's probably a coin toss or maybe even a Jaguars favorite because they are more familiar with playing in England. So Mike has taken the value pick there. He's taken the familiarity with the overseas travel, maybe Chicago and a little bit of a letdown after a couple big wins. Jacksonville backs against the wall, playing in what is essentially a home game for them in England. And obviously, he's getting good odds. He's getting the plus 115. So Mike has taken a $200 bet, Jacksonville Jaguars over the Chicago Bears. Again, I want to be mad about that. If he were here, I'd probably ride him a little bit harder for it, but I do get it. Problem is for me as a Chicago fan, they're sitting at 3-2, and then you start getting this little, like, completely false hope for the playoffs. And I want to admit that right now. As good as their defense has been, as good as Caleb has been, they're not a playoff team, but you get this little tiny thing when you're over 500, and you're like, man, we're playing a kind of a one-win Jacksonville team. It just feels like this could be setting us up for disappointment. And so I certainly will not be betting any money on Chicago this week. I did lay the points for them against what I thought was a really crummy and proved to be crummy Carolina team, but I'm not going to make the same wager. I'm not going to say it's going to be a mistake, but I do feel like Jacksonville is playing with their backs against the wall for a second week in a row. So Mike has Jacksonville money line over the Bears. Now let's go to his mortgage bets. These are interesting bets. The game of the week in college football this week is Ohio State and Oregon. Top five teams. Oregon's real first big test in the Big Ten. It's still weird for me to say that. Mike would say the Little Ten, but it doesn't change the fact that these are probably the two best teams in the Big Ten playing each other. Ohio State, an underdog at Oregon. And Mike loves the points here, and I don't blame him. Ohio State getting 3 points against Oregon. Ohio State seemingly has one, if not two, of the three best receivers in the country. They have been notoriously slow starters and strong finishers in almost every game they've played. And yet, man, it's hard to take a bet against Oregon, who seems they're not a team of destiny by any stretch. But if there's any team that's coming out of the Pac-12 that looks like they are going to contend for a national championship, it's Oregon. So this is a big game this week. Mike's $300 mortgage bet, he's going to take the 3 points, Ohio State over Oregon. Again, it's hard to take a game that looks like a pretty even matchup, and one team's getting 3 points in a game that could finish, you know, easily 27-28 or something like that. So Mike's first mortgage bet, Ohio State minus 3 over Oregon. And then I'm really proud for him on his last mortgage bet. You know, I've accused him of gambling with his heart this year, and I think he's seen the writing on the wall that Jacoby Brissett probably not going to be the savior for New England, or even a guy who's going to lead them to a victory. They can only muster 10 points against a debilitated Miami Dolphins team. They only gave up 15 points, which is a credit to their defense. But they're playing Houston this week. Houston has established themselves as one of the top three teams in the AFC, as we've talked about. Mike is going to bet against his hometown Patriots. He has already said the losses don't tear him up. They just improve draft value. You get that. It's still hard to bet against your home team. So, Mike, credit to you. Houston minus 7, a $300 bet over New England. That is another mortgage bet. So we got two mortgage bets, Houston minus 7 over the Patriots, and then college football, Ohio State minus 3 over Oregon. Those are the mortgage bets. Both of those are $300. He has taken the Jacksonville money line over the Bears in England for $200. And then Arizona State plus 6.5 over Utah in the college ranks. And then the Bengals and Giants over 48.5. Those are Mike's $1,000 picks this week. And I tell you what, I can't even complain about any of them. I like them. And credit to Mike for turning against his Patriots. I think it's time. That said, they will probably win that game outright. All right, thank you for sticking with us for a half an hour tonight. Short one tonight. We are obviously not going to discuss this week the WWE Mr. McMahon series on Netflix. We want to talk about that. I know a lot of you, just like me, grew up watching the WWF and later WWE. So Mike and I will talk about the first couple of episodes next week. And prayers going out to anybody who is getting away from this hurricane, who is affected by the last hurricane. Anybody who, of course, in North Carolina, Tennessee, Georgia, who had to deal with the devastating, you know, residual effects of Hurricane Helene as it moved its way into the Atlantic seaboard. So just a kind of a terrible time here in our country for weather. We're hoping for better days ahead, and we're going to have those. So we'll see you next week. Thanks for joining us tonight. Don't forget, check out freedrop.org and see if we have something for you. Learn about our mission to support children's charities. We've got our donation page up there, and certainly our merchandise page. You have that vintage bundle. We'd love to see you order that. And we'll be back next week. And thanks again for joining us. See you on Beyond the Drop next week.